Assalamu alaikum. On the behalf of Jinnah Sindh Medical University, I welcome you all in the second plenary session of day two of Ramadan and Health Conference based on the theme Ramadan and Diabetes. I request honorable chairpersons of this session. Our first chairperson is Professor Mohammed Furqan. He is a professor and principal of Hamdard Medical College. Sir, please come on the stage. Our second chairperson is Professor Sugra Parveen. She is the Dean of Surgery in Jinnah Postgraduate Medical Center. Ma'am, please come on the stage. Now I would request Professor Sugra Parveen to invite our first speaker on the stage and proceed the session. Program schedule is in your files, ma'am.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and a very good afternoon. Our first speaker is Professor Mahfouzi Muhammad. He's our honorable professor from abroad, from Malaysia, a very good country. Professor of Medicine and Senior Consultant. He's endocrinologist at University Sindh Health Campus in Kelantan.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And thank you very much, Professor Sugra, for that very kind introduction. And also like to thank once again Professor Nazir Khan for inviting me to this conference. It's always been my pleasure to come to Pakistan. So I've been asked to talk about glycemic excursions in Ramadan. Essentially, I'll be talking about the variations in glucose control and in terms of its clinical impact, and what we can do in terms of trying to reduce this glucose excursion. I think coming back in terms of, I'm sure you all know that in terms of the physiology of fasting during Ramadan, for a normal person, when a person is not taking any food, then obviously the insulin level actually comes down to almost minimal. And this will rise to depletion of the glucose from the liver, okay, because most of the glucose in the fasting state comes from the liver, and the formation of glucose, again from the liver, from the breakdown from muscles and adipose tissue. Okay. When the fasting is much prolonged, then the muscles make use of the adipose tissue, i.e. the fatty acids, to form ketones, and ketones now becomes the fuel for metabolism. In this case, because of that, then essentially a person is able to survive fasting for long periods of time because of that fact. In terms of the pathophysiology for diabetics, that diabetics normally the main cause of that is reduction in insulin levels. Okay? So people in type 1 diabetes, their glucose homeostasis is very much affected by the fact that they don't have any insulin. Okay? That will give rise to quite severe hyperglycemia produced by the liver. Okay? At the same time, with the severe insulin deficiency and the fact that now ketone bodies are formed, and without the presence of insulin, this can give rise to severe hyperglycemia and eventual ketoacidosis. The other aspects, okay, the reverse aspects in terms of the hyperglycemia, is of course is hypoglycemia. Okay? And the hypoglycemia in diabetes is basically because of the medications that the patients are taking, either the orals or the insulin. So that is the main pathogenesis as far as glucose metabolism in diabetics and fasting state is concerned. And of course, in terms of its clinical impact, okay, then as you all know that the impacts of fasting in diabetes is one of course is hyperglycemia and ketoacidosis, okay, as I mentioned in the pathophysiology. So this is very, you've seen this slide before, that it's very much increased in people with type 2 diabetes during Ramadan compared to the non-Ramadan months. Okay, both hyperglycemia and as I mentioned, the hypoglycemia is essentially because of the medications that the patients are taking. Okay? And type 1 diabetes again, hyperglycemia and ketoacidosis is very much increased compared to non-fasting month. And of course, hypoglycemia is similarly very much increased compared to the non-fasting month. Now, and this is, as I mentioned, because of this fact that they lack insulin, okay, this is what happened in terms of the glucose variability. Okay, during using the continuous glucose monitoring, this happens in people who are non-diabetics. Okay, you can see during the fasting and the non-fasting state, okay, that the levels of glucose remains almost constant, okay, throughout the day, okay, simply because the fact that there is compensatory in terms of gluconeogenesis and prevention of hyperglycemia, both especially after iftar. Okay? Remarkable stability of blood glucose during fasting hours and minimal rise of blood glucose at iftar. Okay? In people with type 2 diabetes, is that this is a non-fasting state. Even in the non-fasting state, as you can see, there is marked variability, okay, or glucose excursion in the blood glucose levels, continuous glucose monitoring, even in non-fasting state. And in the fasting state, okay, you have a dip in the blood glucose just before iftar because of the prolonged fasting. And after iftar, there's a marked increase in terms of the postprandial blood glucose simply because of the meal that the patient had. Okay? Very much so that this may be due because in the fasting and non-fasting state, possibly one is due to the diet, and secondly, due to the medication. So again, this suggests that people in Ramadan, or fasting for that matter, there is increase in glucose variability in people with diabetes compared to people without diabetes, and this puts them at risk, okay, of hypoglycemia, and this dip, and hyperglycemia in this peak. Okay, so that is the increase in glucose or glycemic excursions in people with diabetes. So the question is this a common phenomenon? Yeah, that is glucose mark variability, glucose excursion, is it well known and a fact that is inescapable, i.e. people with diabetes will have these excursions, whatever. And there are studies now, I won't go into that, that it's not only the A1C that determines complications, but it's also glucose variability. Okay, the higher the glucose variability between the peaks and the trough, okay, the higher is the risk of complication. So later studies, that was the first study using CGM in people with diabetes, is that this is looking at CGMs in people with type 2 diabetes, and just point that these patients, this group of patients, are fairly well controlled. In fact, it's brilliant in terms of its control, 6.3 A1C. Yeah. When they look at before Ramadan and during Ramadan, of course, there is the hyperglycemia percentage, okay, based on the CGMs, is much lower, okay, in Ramadan compared to before Ramadan, okay, which is significant. So which means that this study is opposite to the study that was shown earlier, i.e. people with Ramadan has less hyperglycemic peaks or periods of hyperglycemia compared to those before Ramadan. And when they look at the, in these patients are on metformin and metformin SU or SU alone. Okay? Looking at the percent of hyperglycemia events before Ramadan, there was significantly increased, okay, in the metformin SU group, okay, compared to the metformin group. I.e. metformin gives some sort of stability in terms of the blood glucose over the 24 hours. Whereas people with metformin, the percentage of hyperglycemic events was higher, okay, in before Ramadan in metformin SU and SU group. And interestingly, that when during fasting month, it is very much reduced. Okay, again, the glucose variability that you see before Ramadan is much decreased now during Ramadan, suggesting that for this type of people, Ramadan actually gives them a better glucose control, glycemic control over the month. And looking at the hypoglycemic events based on the CGMs, metformin 0.11%, and quite significantly higher for metformin SU or the SU group. Again, not surprising because SUs, as you all know, are hypoglycemic agents, whereas metformin is not a hypoglycemic agent. It doesn't cause hypoglycemia. So again, not surprising from that study, but what was significant was that Ramadan fasting defies to reduction in hypoglycemic events, and the extent and duration of hypoglycemia, again, was not significantly different between the two states, Ramadan and before Ramadan. A significant increase in number of hypoglycemic events in Ramadan found in patients taking SU compared to those taking only insulin. So this is one study suggests that, in fact, the so-called peaks that you get before Ramadan is actually much better attenuated for fasting. But again, possibly in these studies, they are well controlled and they have been given proper Ramadan-specific diabetes education. Okay. This is another study, again looking at the variability using CGMS in patients type 2 diabetes. Again, these patients were adjusted. Okay, before they go into fasting, they were given diabetes-specific education, specifically in terms of diet. Okay. And this group of patients, the diabetes is probably not too well controlled. The mean A1C is 7.6%. Okay. And when they look at all the CGMS parameters, okay, looking at standard deviation and so on, mean amplitude and conga and etc., okay, they were not significantly different between the fasting and the non-fasting period. Okay, suggesting that fasting in Ramadan do not cause, okay, significant deterioration in glycemic excursions, okay, if the patients are, in this case, are properly educated. Okay. Suggest that systemic pre-Ramadan assessment with appropriate therapeutic adjustments and educational advice regarding healthy diet, adequate exercise, and awareness of risk of hypo and hyperglycemia are important in negating the previously described glycemic variability seen during Ramadan. Okay. This is another study, again looking at CGMS, type 2 diabetes. Okay. Again, these patients are fairly well controlled. A1C before Ramadan is 6.7%. Okay. And what they found was that the so-called variability, okay, is mainly in the early part of Ramadan. Okay. Pre-Ramadan and early Ramadan was significantly higher, okay, in early Ramadan. But late Ramadan and post-Ramadan was not significant. So which means that perhaps in the early phase, okay, these people were adjusting in terms of diet, okay, and lifestyle and so on. So there may be some increase in variability during the early parts of Ramadan. Okay. And they also showed that people who have more than two anti-diabetic medication or an OSU had significantly higher variability compared to those that were on pre-Ramadan. Okay? So these people, again, similar to that, the first study that I mentioned, suggesting that SUs, okay, may make the glycemic variability worse. Maybe perhaps it's not so much hyperglycemia, but the hypoglycemia. Okay? So again, the conclusion from that study that except for initial increase in glucose variability, fasting during Ramadan for patients with non-insulin treated type 2 diabetes did not cause any significant changes in metabolic control, glucose fluctuation, or time in hypoglycemia during continuous glucose monitoring recordings compared to the non-fasting pre-Ramadan period. Suggesting that perhaps if it's proper management, proper monitoring, you can eliminate the so-called glucose variability, hypers and hypoglycemia during Ramadan. Now, this is where I think the importance, how do you prevent this glucose variability? As I've indicated earlier, the latest studies actually had patients who underwent proper nutrition counseling. Okay? That the main aim of the Ramadan nutrition plan, okay, as advocated by the IDF-DA, is that to balance, okay, proportion of macronutrients during the fasting period, okay, to prevent hypoglycemia during the fasting period. So that's number one. And the second aim is to distribute the carbohydrate carb intake equally among meals to minimize postprandial hyperglycemia. So this plan, okay, takes into cognizance the fact that you can get postprandial hyperglycemia and also at the same time that pre-iftar hypoglycemia, daytime hypoglycemia, if the patients do not practice proper nutrition. Okay. So these are some of the unhealthy nutrition habits that develop during Ramadan. I'm sure you're very familiar with that, okay? In the sense that the patients take very large meals at iftar, frequently more than 1,500 calories, okay? Usually, we do advocate that per meal, okay, you should not exceed more than 500 calories. Okay? But in fasting month, this is three times the amount of calories that the patient takes. Then secondly, they eat significantly high amount of processed carbohydrate and sugar at iftar, or between iftar and suhoor, which may cause severe hyperglycemia. Okay? And again, they take desserts, which are loaded with sugar after iftar, which can also cause prolonged period of postprandial hyperglycemia. Okay? And they take large frequent snacks between two main meals, okay? Because in certain countries, they don't sleep during the night. Okay? They basically eat throughout the night and you sleep in the daytime. Okay? So that is another problem, excessive amount of intake at night. Also eating at fast speed, so which is one of the causes of obesity. Because if you eat fast, because our body takes about 30 minutes to stimulate the satiety center. So if you were to eat very fast within that 30 minutes, your satiety center is not yet stimulated, and because of that, you tend to overeat. Eating suhoor early, which may result in hypoglycemia before iftar, especially when fasting hours are longer than usual. Consumption of 5 portions of high glycemic carbohydrates at suhoor, which can lead to postprandial hyperglycemia. So those are mainly in terms of the carb management during Ramadan to prevent hyper and hypoglycemia. Okay? So in terms of the objective of Ramadan nutrition plan is to minimize through proper nutrition hypoglycemia, especially during the late period of fasting before iftar, severe hyperglycemia after each of the main meals, and of course other aspects as well, which are fairly common. So those are the, in fact, the two main concern, okay, of objective of this plan is really to prevent the so-called hyperglycemia and hypoglycemia. So that's one. So what about medications? What medications can reduce the so-called glycemic variability? Okay? So these are the studies. Many of the studies are actually not done during Ramadan, okay, but showing that between oral anti-hyperglycemic agent or even there are differences as far as effect on glycemic variability. This one looking at acarbose compared to placebo. Again, showing that the acarbose decreased the intraday glucose variability, especially postprandial. As you all know, acarbose works mainly at the postprandial level. So showing that perhaps acarbose is better compared to other medications in reducing the hyperglycemic peaks. Looking at the DPP-4 in general between saxagliptin and acarbose, that both saxa and acarbose reduce glucose variability to a similar extent, okay? Even though the greater reductions in A1C and fasting plasma glucose are seen with saxagliptin. Okay? Sitagliptin versus glimepiride, both sitagliptin and glimepiride reduce A1C, however, significant reduction observed in amplitude of glucose variation based on the mean amplitude of glucose excursion. Yeah. And vildagliptin compared to pioglitazone also similarly that reduction in glucose variability seen only with vildagliptin, so suggesting that the DPP-4 has better in terms of reducing the glucose variability compared to either glimepiride or pioglitazone. GLP-1 receptor agonist, this is liraglutide, okay, compared to insulin, again showing that liraglutide is better in terms of reduction in A1C and glucose variability compared to insulin therapy alone. Dapagliflozin against saxagliptin, this is the only study that was done during Ramadan. It's a paper from Malaysia from one of our fellows, suggesting that dapagliflozin significant reduction in mean glucose levels, but in terms of the glucose variability, not much difference between the two. Again, you would expect that dapagliflozin would not have very much effect on the glucose variability because it affects mainly overall glucose levels. Okay. And rapid acting basal analogs compared to exenatide, compared metformin, insulin and exenatide, okay, showing that the GV glucose variability indices not significant improvement, non-significant improvement towards exenatide. Okay. and insulin rispro versus insulin glargine. Not surprisingly, because this is basal insulin alone, this is prandial insulin, that the variability is much less with lispro compared to glargine alone. Okay, and insulin determine and glargine, no significant difference between the two. Can okay? Be both basal and log. Insulin glargine standard of care, also do not show much in terms of MACE to compared to the standard care. Did not increase hypoglycemia, similar SD and MACE. Okay, and the IDAC lira and insulin glargine lixisenatide combination of insulin and GLP-1 receptor agonist showing that the glucose variability is much reduced as far as these two medications are concerned. So in general, the agents that work at the postprandial level are carbos, okay? The alpha glucosidase inhibitors, the DPP-4 inhibitors, and the GLP-1 receptor agonist works better in reducing glucose glycemic variability. Now we're about the people with type 1 diabetes. Okay? What is the effect on the glucose variability? This is one study showing pump and multiple dose insulin injection that over the 24 hours against going the CGMS, yeah, that there seems to be a remarkable constant, yeah, throughout the day. The only significant difference, the pump is probably slightly lower compared to multiple dose injection at this point in time. Okay? Suggesting that again, showing the variability is almost identical. And the only difference in that study was that in terms of standard deviation of the average blood glucose was significantly better for, or significantly better for insulin pump as compared to multiple dose. But apart from that, all the other parameters in the CGMS is identical. So they concluded that in patients with type 1 diabetes who fast during Ramadan, no significant difference in rates of hypoglycemia or hyperglycemia between the continuous infusion and the multiple dose injection. However, the continuous subcutaneous insulin infusion is associated with less glucose variability compared to the multiple dose injection. Okay. This is going a new technique, the flash glucose monitoring system, and comparing people with on the pump and the multiple daily injections. In terms of the days reported, in terms of fasting and non-fasting period, there were no significant difference between the multiple daily injections and the pump. Okay? But what was significant in terms of hypoglycemia that makes the patient break the fast, okay, is significantly higher in the multiple in daily injections insulin compared to those with pump, suggesting that perhaps to prevent hypoglycemia, the pump is better than the pump is better compared to the multiple dose injection insulin. Okay. Looking at the hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia events during fasting and non-fasting hours, okay, that essentially the hypoglycemia events, okay, is much less, okay, in the fasting hours in the pump compared to the MDI, suggesting that again, pump is probably better to prevent hypoglycemia, okay, but the rest are quite identical. Okay. So they concluded from there that these people with type 1 diabetes, they are using technology of flash glucose monitoring, frequent scanning of sensor could detect earlier detection of hypoglycemia and hyperglycemic episode, and they do not have any DKA episodes in either groups of patients, suggesting that if you monitor these people properly, okay, then they should be able to fast even without severe hypoglycemia or keto diabetic ketoacidosis. So the essence is that in patients who have high risk, okay, and multiple dose injections, important is to monitor the blood glucose. Okay, you may not have to rely on the CGMS as long as you monitor them properly at least at 6 points in time, then you can prevent both severe hyperglycemia and severe hypoglycemia by adjusting the doses of their medication. So this is one of the other aspects that we need to focus on to try to reduce so-called the glucose excursions seen during Ramadan. So in conclusion then, ladies and gentlemen, increased glycemic variability is common during Ramadan. Okay? This is due to daytime fasting and nighttime feasting. Okay? Basically, the main reason of this glycemic variability is in terms of the diet. Okay? And this can lead to significant hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia, which are the clinically significant events that makes patients either go to hospitals or become unconscious at home. To prevent this so-called excursion, is proper pre-Ramadan education and nutrition planning that can reduce glycemic variability. I've shown you studies that have shown that have done that. An adjustment of anti-hyperglycemic medications can reduce glycemic variability. And I've shown you that there are some medications who are better at trying to reduce this glycemic variability. And regular glucose monitoring is useful to prevent significant hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia for patients who are fasting during Ramadan. Thank you very much for your attention.
I think because of the time constraint, we will keep question answers in the end. And I will request the respectable speakers to please remain in the time.
Assalamu alaikum. Now I will request Professor Mohammad Yaqub Ahmedani, Baqa Institute of Diabetology and Endocrinology, to present its presentation of Ramadan specific diabetic education lessons learned.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Nahmaduhu nasalli ala rasulil kareem. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I would like to thank Professor Nazir Saab and the organizers that they have given me this opportunity to talk on this important subject of pre-Ramadan education, what lessons we have learned so far. Our Ramadan and Hajj study group, which we have formed 10, 11 years back, have done several of the studies on education, the role of education in patients who are fasting. And what studies, I'm showing you our studies which we have done on this subject, and we have learned a lot, and I think we want to share these studies with you. So the question is whether it is important to educate people and doctors before Ramadan for patients who are fasting, whether education matters or not. Several of the studies I will show you have shown. This is first study which has looked into the awareness level of patients who are fasting during the month of Ramadan. This is an old study, but subsequently we have done another study this last year, but in fact this year it is under publication and gone for the in the process of publication. In this study they have shown that was the medication dose adjusted before Ramadan? 18% of the patients were saying that no, medications were not adjusted before Ramadan. As Professor Mahfouzi has shown that medication adjustment is important. If you adjust the doses before Ramadan, then the variability, glucose variability will be less. When the question was asked, how many people were monitoring during Ramadan? 30% of the patients said that they didn't monitor their sugars during Ramadan. Fair enough, its conclusion is that 70% were monitoring then. But what was the frequency of monitoring? 60% of the patients were monitoring just once a month or thrice a month. So practically speaking, they were not monitoring. If you are monitoring just once a month or thrice a month, this is not monitoring. As shown in earlier lecture, that it has to be you have to monitor several times a day, not just once in a month. So this was the level of awareness in our patients, among our patients. 18% of the patients, when they felt hypo, what they have done, they have continued the fast. This is again lack of education, that they don't know what to do when they develop hypoglycemia. So these were the questions. Do you believe needle prick can break the fast? 28% said that needle prick can break the fast. So lack of awareness among patients. 54% were saying that insulin injection should not be taken at sahur. 45% were saying in double dose should be taken at iftar and not a dose at sehri. 53% were saying that normal